All right. Hey, good morning. Welcome to church. How's everybody doing today? You guys are looking good. Come on in, grab a seat. We want to welcome you to First Baptist Church today. My name is Glenn Barnes. I'm the lead pastor here, and we are just so glad that you are with us as we worship together this morning. We've got a great morning together, and this is really the beginning. We've been kind of focusing towards this all year long as we've been reading through the Gospels as a church together. But we are in the home stretch, and today we kind of begin what's known as Holy Week, and that last week of Christ's life, where so much was done on our behalf through his death and then, of course, through his resurrection. And so we are glad that you're here. Today is Palm Sunday, and we'll hear a little bit about that. Our kids are going to sing with us today, so we have a great morning. Hey, as we get started, I always want to just take a few minutes and not only welcome you, but make sure that you have all the information you need about how to connect into the life of the church. So a few little announcements. First of all, if you are new to the church or you have anything that you need to communicate to the church staff, we have those connection cards. That's a great way to stay in touch. Those are in the little seat pocket in front of you. And feel free to use those for anything that you would like to communicate to the church. If you are not receiving the weekly emails, we would love to have your email so you could kind of stay up through that. Use one of those cards, or if you have prayer requests, anything like that. As I'm thinking about prayer too, let me just remind you, you can use those prayer cards, but also we've got our prayer walls always out. You're welcome to put a prayer up there. Sometimes just walking forward and writing that out and putting it on there kind of solidifies it, and so feel free to use that, and we have our prayer team. And then also right over here to my right, we have a prayer room that's open during the service. You're welcome to go over there anytime and either pray by yourself or have someone pray for you, and then they'll be available at the end of the service as well. So hey, as far as giving, we're so grateful for your giving as we give. You know, Jesus, when he calls us to follow him in every area of our life, including our finances. So one way we do that is through generosity and through giving. And there's a few different ways you can give. You can give online through the church app. And then there's also, we'll have ushers at the end of the service today to collect your offering if you would like to. So, hey, a few things about this week coming up. First of all, we've mentioned for a couple weeks now that next Sunday on Easter, we are having baptisms. So if you are still interested in being baptized, we do have room for that. And you could just use one of those cards, let me know. We'd love to just talk to you about how to get ready for that. But like I said, we still have room. But why don't you let me know at the end of the service if you're interested in being baptized? That'd be terrific. So also, our Good Friday experience is coming this Friday, which is Good Friday, the day that we remember Christ's death on the cross. And I've explained this a little bit, but let me just say one more time. This is a little different than what we've done in the past, but I think has the potential to just be really meaningful. So the way it's going to work is it's more kind of interactive. And you'll show up here to the church, and station number one will be right in the front of the church. And we have, I think, 8 different kind of stations of the cross that will be around the church campus. So it's kind of a self-guided experience, and you go to each station, and there's some things to experience and read and think about and connect with, and then you kind of move on throughout. So it'll probably take around 45 minutes, maybe a little longer if you want to linger in certain places, but plan on about 45 minutes, and it's the kind of thing that you can come anytime during the day. So anytime between 9 in the morning and 8 at night, you just come. It's self-guided. It's on your time. One of us will meet you out front to kind of get you started and get you going. But from that, you'll move on. And it's, I think it has a potential to be a really powerful thing. So plan on that as a part of your day on Friday. And come with your family. Come with whoever. It's going to be really a great experience. And then next Sunday is Easter Sunday. So a few little announcements about that. First of all, on the back of your message notes today are all the details, including about our sunrise service, which is not at Lodi Lake this year because Lodi Lake is closed. So it's actually at a private residence out in the country, out on Alpine Road. You can see the address there, and it's printed on your bulletin. 6 a.m. out there. It's always a great time. The service will actually be very similar to what we've done at Lodi Lake, just minus a lake. And Jake McGregor is actually going to be preaching at that message or that service out there. So that's always a barrel of fun. Come on out for that. And I'll be out there as well. Would love to see you at 6 a.m. for our sunrise service. Then right here on campus at 8 a.m., 9:30, and 11 o'clock, we're going to have Easter celebration services. They're just going to be a great celebration of the resurrection of Christ, what that means for us. There's going to be a little brunch as you come in and out. But plan on what service would work for you, who you could invite. You know, people are all always open to coming to church, especially on a day like Easter, but they're often waiting for someone to just invite them. In the early service, we had a beautiful baptism, and the lady that gave the testimony, a big part of the testimony was, someone just invited me to church, and it changed my life. And so that does happen, and we encourage you to think about who you could invite next Easter. And then finally, let me just remind you, for our families, we have our at-home ministry, which are different materials to help you in kind of the discipleship of your family. And so we've got a few resources for kids about Easter week. And so please stop by the at-home thing, parents. Grab those. If you want to do some devotions with your kids this week, some creative ideas, there's a number of different cards and materials. Grab those, and you will not be sorry that you did. All right, well, why don't I just begin with a word of prayer. We're really excited. Pastor Steven Rossi is going to be leading us in our message this morning. Just a little word about your message notes. Some of you came in. It's going to be a little tough for you note takers, for you fill in the blank folks. But trust me, you are going to be blessed by this morning's message, and you're going to be encouraged and challenged like I was at the early service. So would you join me in a word of prayer as we commit this to you? Father, I thank you so much for your presence here with us. Father, what an amazing time it is together to come as your church family. Father, we are imperfect. We come carrying the weight of sin. We come carrying the weight of this week. We come with all sorts of different things, but we come together in the name of our perfect Savior, Jesus Christ. And on the day, Lord, that we remember that you came into Jerusalem and the crowd shouted, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Father, would we join our voices to that as well? Would we say, "Blessed are you, Father, you come in the name of the Lord." And I pray, Lord, that our lives and our church would be a place of true worship of you. So, Father, speak to us. We invite you through the words of these songs that we sing, through the young and the old people singing them together on stage, through the opening up of your word, through the time that we have together as the family of God, Father, would you work? I thank you for each person here. We open our hearts to you so that you could work. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning, church. This is the opening. This is the beginning of Holy Week, and we are going to celebrate that. It's Palm Sunday. We've got some special treats. The Made for Praise Choir is going to be joining us. You know, this was the one time in Jesus' earthly life. I'm getting signals here. This is a different mic. Here we go. All right. Palm Sunday, Made for Praise Choir. All right, yeah, so we're good. You know, this is the one day in Jesus' earthly life where he not only allowed himself to be hailed as king, he actually arranged it and set it up. And it fulfills so many prophecies. Zechariah said, "Behold, your king approaches, coming on humbly on a donkey, foal of a donkey." Anyway, there are so many exciting things. So we are going to celebrate the kingship of Jesus in our life. Amen? That he is king of our life. So would you stand and greet those around you? I'm going to invite the Made for Praise Choir to come on up and get in place. And let's do this together. Thank you.
praise this morning, church. He's good, amen. God, we celebrate your kingship this morning. In Christ Jesus, our King. The King of kings and the Lord of lords. And we look to you this morning. We offer our worship to you as a sweet fragrance to your ears. God, you love us, and we love you. Hear your people. All of Father's song, in the days of old, would you do it again? Would you do it again? All the stories told, all the miracles, would you do it again? Do it again. You said, consecrate yourselves to me. You will see amazing things. We need your revival. Holy Spirit, fire burning ever brighter in our soul. Kings and kingdoms fall.
And the final is rising in his name.
His glory surrounds us, and His fire is falling as we sing. And the Savior is for us, and His love is victorious, and our honor is rising in His
God, we just thank you for your goodness and your favor toward us. Father, I thank you for these kids. I thank you for the families that are represented. Would you be near to them, Lord God? Would you, especially in this week coming up, would you speak life into our lives, Lord God, as you do so wondrously well, Lord God, that we might encounter you, we might experience you, we might follow you through this week and into the rest of our life, Lord God. We love you and we commit the service to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated, church.
Amen. Good morning. Hey, kids, you are dismissed to Children's Church. Have an awesome time. Hey, can we one more time give a round of applause for our Made for Praise Choir? That was beautiful. How fun is that to be led into worship by our team and especially by those kids? My name is Steven Rossi. I'm the high school pastor here at First, and I'm honored to serve in this capacity, but I'm also honored to be up here and be opening God's Word with us today. As Glenn pointed out, there are a few differences in the sermon notes this morning. So for those of you who are eager to have fill in the blanks, I apologize. I am just so for your freedom to write whatever notes that you want that I didn't want to bind you by you know, those like really oppressive fill in the blanks. You know what I mean? It had nothing to do at all that I'm not used to the rhythm of getting things into Ian by Thursday so it's in print. That has nothing to do with it. It has more, it's a philosophical thing, all right? But even though there's not going to be as many visual things, the scriptures aren't going to be on the screens and things like that, what I would ask is maybe one of the benefits of that is that we would grab the Bibles in front of us and the seat backs in front of you. If you have a Bible, maybe that you would open that with us. If you don't have one and you can't see one in front of you, maybe open your phone to it. And that we would open scripture together and participate as a group of people, not just, please, don't come here to hear me speak and entertain you, but that we would participate and open God's Word together. And so, since there won't be as much on the screen, let me just tell you real briefly, if you want to get your, you know, flip to these pages and have them dog-eared or stick your finger in the Bible to before we get to them, we're going to be going into Romans chapter 5 and chapter 6, Ephesians chapter 2, and then spending a bulk of our time in John chapter 11. So if you want to flip there and just ahead of the game a little bit, Romans chapter 5 and 6, Ephesians chapter 2, and then we'll spend some time in John chapter 11. Well, as you guys are flipping there, before we start opening and reading that scripture, as the high school pastor and being in youth ministry for the last 15 years, there's a lot of different skills that I've gained. I don't know if I could say that I'm an expert at anything, but I think there's maybe a few things that I have proudly more experience than many of you at. One of which I think that I would proudly boast that I have probably experienced worse smells than any of you have. Both in like random eating games where we blend disgusting stuff together, or simply, I think one of the things would just be the experience, this is, many of you have had this experience too, not just me, just the hug from a junior high boy, just that by itself right there, you know, when they're not quite in the rhythm of using deodorant yet, that's one smell. Another one that comes to mind is an admissions trip down to Los Angeles. We were in triple bunk beds in this small, tiny room, and half of my boys in that room ate something bad, and in the middle of the night, just a fountain of different fluids were splattering by my bed, and there's a stench that comes with that that will forever be imprinted on my mind that just sticks with you. And then there's also winter camp the last 2 years. So 2 years ago, I was in a cabin with the upperclassmen guys, and one of the cabins there, I don't know if you guys have experienced this, but certain smells, you kind of walk into a room, and it just feels like something punches you right in the face. Like, it's just, like physically, you have to respond to how bad the smell is. And so I open the door to our guys' cabin, and immediately I'm just frustrated. Like, how could it smell this bad already? And luckily, this was nothing to do with those boys at this particular instance. There had to have been something different. I'm pretty sure there was something that died in the walls of that cabin. And so we walk in, and it was just awful in there. And made worse by the fact that they used their Axe cologne spray to just try to cover the smell. So there was an Axe bomb in there that was just this mix of cologne, and I'm pretty sure some sort of smell of death, of a rodent or something that was in there. And I share all of that to say there is a point to this. There's an actual passage, and when we're going to be talking about the miracle of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead, and there is a passage where it speaks to the odor of what that could be. And there's something about the physical smell of death that is important for us to briefly mention. But more than just the smell and the memory and the feeling of what that smell brings to me, and what you have experienced, for many of you who have experienced rotting or death or something like that, there's something in the consistency that the Bible speaks to in death. And there's something about this, before we head into the passage of Lazarus and what Jesus does to this body and to this person who is a friend of his, I think that it's important for us to briefly catch up to where the Bible has been, and both before and after this passage, stuff that Paul has written here in Romans about this consistency that the Bible talks about of death on our lives, not just for someone like Lazarus, but spiritually, this death that is hanging over us. And so Romans chapter 5, verse 12, would you follow along with me as I read that? Romans chapter 5, verse 12 says this: "Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned." And so clearly speaking of Adam's sin here at the beginning, where in Genesis 3, Adam sins, and because of sin, death enters the world. And because all have sinned, all experience death. So there's this progression that the Bible talks about. And if you go down just a chapter later to Romans chapter 6, verse 23, it says this: "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." The wages, the outcome, what we deserve from that sin is death. So the things that caused us to not match up with God, the outcome and the overflow of that is death. And Ephesians chapter 2 perhaps illustrates this and displays this practically for us well. And so if you would flip a few books over to the right, in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, it says this: "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body." So rereading the beginning of verse 3, it says, "among whom we all once lived." Paul making it clear here in the Greek that word "all" means all, right? Like, it is just simple. Every single one of us has sinned. There's not one of us. Whether you've been born and raised in the church and you are someone who from diapers has been in this church and developing habits within the church and knowing about Jesus, you have sinned. And if you are someone who is the complete opposite and you were born in a family that has cursed God or done followed him in rejecting God, you have also been born in sin. It doesn't matter who we are, where we come from. So Ephesians 2 does a good job of calling all of us, calling the sinners up and recognizing that we are here, and calling the self-righteous, those who think we are above that, down into the same playing field. All of us experience death. And that stench and that odor and this disgusting level that I was talking about, as much as that was a story of something physical, there's something true about that we all experience as well. There's something of death that we all experience, not just in our lives of loved ones, but spiritually, there's something a part of us that is naturally rotting and bent towards the broken. There's something a part of us spiritually that is in need of help and in need of a Savior. And so as we establish that fact, the fact that we all are in sin and we all are deserving of death, we then can jump into, in a second here, John chapter 11, where we see Jesus engaging with death. And this miracle is so cool because, like other miracles, I think this miracle points to the fact, is maybe the second most important miracle in the Bible, because it is the one that precursors next week. It's the one where he is raising to life a person who has died, and that precursors so well his own life and his defeat of death itself. And so let's read together in John chapter 11. We're going to split this up just a little bit. And so we're going to read verses 1 through 16 together with me. So John chapter 11, 1 through 16, we'll start here. It says this: "Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him, saying, 'Lord, he whom you love is ill.' But when Jesus heard it, he said, 'This illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it.'" Remember that verse 4, what Jesus said right there. Moving on in verse 5. Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Let's pause just quickly for a second there. When you hear of someone, you being Jesus, having the power to heal somebody from death or stop sickness from causing death, and you hear of your friend who you love is imminent of death, wouldn't you expect him to drop everything and go at that point? Wouldn't you expect him to say, oh, man, I'm going to go. Let me go there. But we don't see that. In fact, he waits 2 days longer and continues to go. Verse 7, after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you. And are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him. After saying these things, he said to them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover. Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought he meant taking rest in sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died, and for your sake I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him. So highlight in your mind verse 15 and verse 4 as we remember, and we'll come back to that. And then he continues, Thomas says, Thomas called the twins, said to his fellow disciples, let us go that we may die with him also. So briefly, as we set up what's happening before Jesus arrives at this place in Bethany, there's a few different things happening. One, Jesus is not super close. We already established that he's a little bit further away. It takes him multiple days to get back. We'll see in a second that it took him 4 days Lazarus has been dead for 4 days by the time he's there. But in verse 4 and 14, it's clear that as Jesus is heading into this place and before he engages with Lazarus, Jesus is aware of what has happened. He already knows that Lazarus is dead, not just ill like he was informed, but he already knows that Lazarus is dead. And it's also clear that he already knows the purpose for which it has happened. So he is not some common person entering into a tragedy. He is aware fully what is going to happen, and he knows that he's going to use this for his glory's sake. That's important later as we understand some other things that Jesus does. But as we continue to read, we're going to jump in, continue to read in verse 17. Here's what I want you to pay attention to. We've established that there's this consistent theme of death in Scripture, right? There is death that follows us. We are deserving of death because of our sin. Now, we have two options, and this is what I want us to look for in the Scripture as we are aware of this. We're going to look at a story of Jesus raising someone from the dead, which is unbelievable, and it will end with this, and it's beautiful. But there's so many interactions with the people before this where they are engaging with Jesus and what he's about to do. And what's interesting is each one of them has their own expectation of the way Jesus should do his job, right? Mary and Martha are going to have their expectation. The disciples, we already saw in verse 11 right there, they have their expectation. Well, we shouldn't go, Jesus. People are going to stone you. The Jews are trying to stone you. And so I want us, as we read these next few verses, to pay attention to the attempts of the other people at bringing life from death. Because I think for us, as we get to the end, we're going to have to process something in this. There is only life in Jesus, but we have the temptation to try to seek life on our own. Is that fair to say? There's only death, there's only life in Jesus, but oftentimes we try to seek life on our own accord or in our own standards. And so let's continue to read here. John chapter 11, verse 17 says this. Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So there's a group of people mourning with them. This is not just a family by itself. It's a group of people wailing and mourning with them as per tradition. Verse 20, so when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Now, pay attention to this. Jesus is trying to say something to her, and she is right in what she says, but she's missing the point. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, whom is coming into the world. We continue on in verse 28. When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary, saying in private, the teacher is here and is calling you. And when she heard it, she rose quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who were with her in the house consoling her saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Let's pause there for a second. In the midst of what Jesus is doing here, we see a few different reactions. One, there's an expectation that Jesus would have come sooner from both Mary and Martha, right? We already established this too, but the disciples' expectation of Jesus was to put a priority on their safety. Jesus, why would we go back to this area when people are ready to kill you? Let's not cause more commotion. If he's dying, let him be. If he's sleeping, let him be. Let's stay here. The disciples have their own thoughts of what Jesus should do. Martha, in verse 21, thought Jesus should have come sooner, right? In verse 24, let's reread that briefly. In verse 24, Martha says to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Theologically, is that sound? Yeah, right? Like there's teachings of Jesus that speak to what his coming actually means. Maybe not in this first coming, but the second coming, and what the true resurrection of the earth will look like. Martha's answering correctly, yet she's missing what Jesus is doing right in front of her. And in verse 32, now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. And so she falls now at the Savior of the universe, the Messiah, and is dictating her thoughts and her emotions. If you would have done this, and if you would have just done what I would have wanted you to do, what we all would have hoped you would have done, he wouldn't be in this predicament. Jesus, why wouldn't you do this? The point is this. Without Jesus and outside of Jesus, our thoughts, our emotions, our desires, and our actions all lead to death. It doesn't matter what we know or where we come from, if we come from a church background or a non-church background, the moment that we are outside of the will of God is the moment we continue to live in death. And there might be moments where we want Jesus to act differently. There might be moments where we are pleading. In fact, verse 32 is one of the most relatable passages for me in all of this. When she's crying at Jesus' feet and says to him, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died. Is that not so relatable? Have any of you guys asked that question before of Jesus? In the midst of tragedy, in the midst of difficulty, in the midst of confusion, I thought when I signed up to be a Christian that I would get this from you. I thought that because I'm obedient, I would get more from you, Jesus, or I wouldn't have to endure this. In fact, my non-Christian friends seem like they're having a more fun and easier life. So when we attempt in our own life to pull ourselves out of death or in our wisdom, ask God to do what he's going to do in our wisdom, there's just a clarity here in this passage, in this microcosm of the story, that God is doing something bigger than what we desire. And that doesn't mean that it's without hurt. There is hurt in the midst of this. Mary and Martha are on their knees crying and mourning in the midst of this. But it is pointing to the fact that Jesus is doing something outside of their desires for a bigger purpose. Briefly, before we move into the rest of the passage and read of the miracle, which is the exciting part, right? I want us to have a little bit of self-reflection. And this is probably not too new of words necessarily, but I want us to introduce this topic within a Christian self-reflecting terminology of this idea of autonomy versus relationship. Autonomy being this idea of independence or this going about it of myself, and relationship being this idea that I'm connected to the one who created me. We have this temptation in our lives, similar to these examples that we've seen of the disciples, the Jews, Mary and Martha, where our first reaction in the midst of tragedy and pain and suffering is to cling to our desires and our will and our hope for what would happen. And our temptation is to drift to this independence, this autonomy, that I am going to fix this situation. This is how I would do it if I were you, God. And yet the Bible overwhelmingly continues to show that God is doing this subversive work outside of expectations, outside of the religious order, and doing something so much better than what we could have even imagined. The prevention of Lazarus from dying, there is something so much greater about the glory of God that is revealed because of the pain and tragedy that happens here. This is a question, just briefly. What is the first thing that Adam and Eve do after they sin in Genesis 3? They hide, right? God is in a relationship with them physically in this garden, walking around looking, and they hide after they make a mistake. It's this draw to autonomy, to individuality, to independence. When we make a mistake, our first temptation, maybe the foundational temptation of sin, is to drift away from the perfecter of life and fix ourselves before we go back to him. Verse 8 in Genesis 3 says, "And they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, 'Where are you?'" As if he didn't know, right? God having this intimate relationship with this creation, beautiful, unhindered. And he calls out, "Where are you?" As if he doesn't know where they are. And he said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself." And so what we see here, I just want us to point out and be a little self-reflective of our own lives. This temptation is massive, and it's hidden in our lives sometimes. We think that this draw to autonomy and independence is good sometimes, but really what Jesus is calling us back to, regardless if it's sin or tragedy, is submission and relationship every single time. Here are a few ways that some writers recently have started to describe and identify the Christian temptation. This is through some of the spiritual formation work of Dallas Willard, some of the conversations we've been having about discipleship and being a follower of Jesus. This specifically is these terms are written by a guy named John Coe, who started the Institute for Spiritual Formation at Biola University, and I've stolen some of these things from him. But he identifies these things, and again, I'm not saying these terms to cast stones at you or to say, "Hey, church, you guys are these bad Christians who think you're being good and you're not." These terms I'm about to do are for all of us, myself included, that I find myself often in the same light that we find Adam and Eve, in the same light that we find the disciples, where I am over here constantly trying to fix myself before I come back to God. And so some of the terminology I think is helpful as we identify some of these temptations in our lives. And the first one is this: being a consumer Christian. Many of us in this room are here on Sundays or come because we feel like it's the right thing. We put a status on our social media that we are Christians, or we like the Christian culture because we've been raised in it. But really what we're saying for some of us is that we like the fire insurance. We don't want to go to hell. So we're going to claim the status of Christ to be a Christian. And I think there's a call for us to be more in relationship with God than just to have a status of being a Christian. The next one is called a dedicated neurotic. It's a weird term, but it's basically this. It's a serious commitment to Christ and a desire to grow and serve, yet as the years go on, there becomes a hidden or not so hidden guilt or shame that they are not as far along as they wish to be. I think I find myself in this situation a lot. I am been a Christian I raised in the Christian church my entire life, yet probably more seriously in high school, I committed my life to Jesus. And so for the past years, I've been striving to become a follower of Jesus and respond well. But oftentimes when I find myself with my shortcomings and I look myself in the mirror and I've come face to face with my sin, when I'm short with my kids, when I'm short with my wife, when I'm ill-tempered, when I react poorly, when I sin, when I just lie or cheat or do something bad, I find myself going, "Oh man, I just need to go listen to that counseling podcast again, or I'm going to go listen to this sermon again." And the dedicated neurotic, like myself, maybe some of you, thinks that we are one sermon away from being a little more holy. Thinks that we're one knowledge nugget away from being a little bit better and closer to God. And the reason that that's an ill foundation temptation is that there is not one thing you can do to become a better Christian. The only thing that makes you a Christian is a complete submission and repentance to the one who saved you and the one who is the author of life. And anything outside of that is sanctification. And that is not your work to do. It is the work of the Holy Spirit in you to do. Now, there is maturity and there is a response to God's work in your life where we become better Christians in the sense that we listen to things, we grow more, we understand naturally how to respond to Jesus better. But the moment we start trying to do those good things or learn those things to be closer to God is the moment we try to do God's job for him. And similar to the dedicated neurotic is the term moral formation. And it's the same thing. Rather than going and trying to fix myself by getting a little more knowledge, it's I try to do the opposite of my bad deed by doing a good deed. So when I mess up or do something sinful or I do something bad, my temptation for those who are forming themselves through moral formation is to say, I'm going to go do these good things instead. And now that I've messed up over there, because I've done all these good things, that kind of counteracts what I'm doing over here. And it's the same temptation. We think on every level that if we do good things, learn more things, that we are somehow better Christians. And the Bible is really clear. Once and for all, when you repent and believe, there is justification through Christ alone, not your own works, lest anyone may boast. And anything outside of that in sanctification is the work of the Holy Spirit as an overflow of the justification that already took place. Are you with me? God is the only one who can defeat that stench of death on our souls. And as much as we may get used to that stench by sitting in that room, and we might get comfortable with the sin and stench of that on our souls and try to alleviate that with the Axe body spray or the moral good or the learning of good things, it is not our own work that ever eliminates that death. It is the work solely in relationship with God that eliminates death. And slowly with God, we develop habits and become more mature believers. We read our Bible more, not to be better Christians, but to be more in a relationship to know that Christ, that Savior who saved us. So let's read John chapter 11, verse 33 through 44 now. We continue in the story, and it says this. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." And then verse 35, it says, Jesus wept. Why would Jesus weep if he knew beforehand that he was going to raise Lazarus from the dead? In verse 4 and verse 14, Jesus clearly knew that Lazarus had died, and he knew that he was going to raise Lazarus from the dead. Why would Jesus weep if he has foreknowledge of these things? I don't know. Your guess is as good as mine. I'm just kidding. I think there's something to this that we need to, as Bible reading Christians, we need to read this kind of thing and go, whoa, this doesn't make sense. Let's unpack this a little more. And simply one thing that I think is pointed here is the term deeply, greatly troubled that's used twice in this verse has more of a weight to it in that's not in English, that's not translated very well. And I think there's some things that that mean greatly troubled that has this anger that Jesus, in knowing what is should be, this life should be, comes face to face with the implications of death, and he hates death because his intention for creation was never to have death. And so he comes face to face with these people whom he loves experiencing this brokenness, and he hurts for them. And he's angered by the fact that death is in front of him and that his loved ones are experiencing this death when he knows the intention of the Creator was to never have death. And there might be more to it too. I think there's some emotional side of Jesus where he just is a perfect counselor too and weeps with those who are weeping. There's a personal side of Jesus that's beautiful in this too. But there's something where Jesus, the author of life and the perfecter of life, comes in contact with death and weeps at it and is angry at it. Verse 36, so the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept him, this man, from dying? Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead for 4 days. Again, this is another one of those situations where, like, Jesus is doing something here, Martha. And her is like, Jesus, I don't think, this isn't like a one of your miracles where, like, you can kind of heal a blind person. He's dead, Jesus. Like, I don't know if you understand this. Like, there's an odor. That stench is going to hit you as soon as that stone is rolled away. And Jesus' response is crazy. It says this. Jesus said to her, verse 40, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me, and I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. Can we just stop for a second and realize that in the Bible, there's a mummy walking out of a tomb right now? Is that not insane? Like, Jesus just does this miracle that is, I mean, it's not insane when you look at next week on Easter, what we're about to experience, right? When we see what ultimately, how this man is the author of life and is the resurrection of life, it's not crazy. But in this particular story, it's crazy. Jesus commands death to be gone, and it is gone. He simply speaks, and death is eradicated. He's not consoling the situation and saying, oh, I'll make it better. Mary and Martha, let me create a new brother for you. He simply speaks, and death is gone. He is the resurrection of life. And it is only through an intimate relationship with God, through Jesus, that we experience life. No matter how hard we try by ourselves to create life and to fix death, we cannot do it outside of Jesus. Using the final term of the spiritual formation stuff, the last term is then spiritual formation. If moral formation doesn't work, being a dedicated neurotic or a consumer Christian doesn't work, it's spiritual formation that is what Jesus wants as we are disciples of him. And spiritual formation is simply this, to be open to what the Holy Spirit is doing inside of you. We're not going to read it, but if you want to read later John chapter 15 and the illustration of the vine and the branches and the oneness that God is calling us into in a relationship, that is what spiritual formation looks like and following Jesus looks like. I'm going to end with a quick illustration and read a little bit from C.S. Lewis's book, The Voyage of the Dawn Treader. I'm not huge into fiction. I don't have a lot of time to read fiction, but growing up, there was two different kind of fiction sci-fi books that I liked, which was Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings and the Chronicles of Narnia series through C.S. Lewis. And some of it's kind of weird, and if you're not into fiction, this is an odd thing. This is not scripture, right? I'm not claiming this to be scripture, but the illustration here, if we're talking about this idea that there is death, and there's only one person who can defeat death, yet our temptation as believers is to fix it ourselves over here, this illustration gives really good language to that. And so to set this up briefly, there's this foreign land that these people, these kids are transported into, and they are part of this land in Narnia. This lion is the God figure, Aslan is the God figure who is beautiful and perfect, just like our God. And this boy Eustace is just a terrible kid. He's a pest. He's horrible. People just hate him the way that he talks. He's annoying. He does all this stuff, and he does these things and gets himself into trouble and is turned into a dragon. I know this is weird, but just go with me here for a second. So he is a dragon, and he just had this experience with Aslan, this God figure lion, who helps him not be a dragon anymore. And here is his words of how Aslan helps him not be a dragon. He says this, I was just going to say that I couldn't undress because I hadn't any clothes on when I suddenly thought that dragons are snaky sort of things and snakes can cast their skins. Oh, of course, thought I. That's what the lion means. So I started scratching myself and my scales began coming off all over the place. And then I scratched a little deeper. And instead of just scales coming off here and there, my whole skin started peeling off beautifully like it does after an illness or as if I was a banana. In a minute or two, I just stepped out of it. I could see it lying there beside me, looking rather nasty. It was a most lovely feeling, so I started to go down into the well for my bath. But just as I was going to put my feet into the water, I looked down and saw that they were all hard and rough and wrinkled and scaly, just as they had been before. "Oh, that's all right," said I. "It only means I had another smaller suit on underneath the first one. I'll have to get out of it too." So I scratched and tore, and this underskin peeled off beautifully, and I stepped out of it lying beside the other one and went down to the well for my bath. Well, exactly the same thing happened again, and I thought to myself, "Oh dear, however many skins have I got to take off?" For I was longing to bathe my leg, so I scratched away for the third time and got rid of a third skin just like the other two and stepped out of it. But as soon as I looked at myself in the water, I knew it had been no good. Is that not a beautiful illustration for the way that we work on our own selves? I try so hard to be a good person. And the moment that I'm frustrated or tired, I revert back to the same sinful nature I had before I even knew Jesus. I try so hard to be a good dad, and the moment my kids are pestering me, I lash out. I try so hard to be a good husband, and the moment that I'm tired and frustrated, I lash out. I am tempted still. I hurt still. No matter how hard I try, no matter what I'm going through, I try so hard, and it's never enough on my own ability. In Romans 8, there is a helper similar to Aslan that's in real life. This isn't fiction anymore. It says this in verse 26 of Romans 8, "Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know what to pray for as we ought to, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God." The Spirit himself is willing and eager to partner with us in relationship and to peel off the brokenness and to push away the stench of death in our lives so that we may become more mature believers and become more like Jesus. The end of the story goes like this, where Eustace says, "I was so afraid of his claws, now he's face to face with Aslan, not doing it himself anymore. But I was pretty nearly desperate now," he says, "so I just lay flat down on my back and let him do it. The very first tear he made was so deep that I thought it had gone right into my heart. And when he began pulling the skin off, it hurt worse than anything I've ever felt. The only thing that made me able to bear it was just the pleasure of the feeling of the stuff peeling off. Well, he peeled the beastly stuff right off, just as I thought I had done myself and the other three times, only they hadn't hurt. And there it was, lying on the grass, only ever so much thicker and darker and more knobbly looking than the others had been. And there was I, as smooth and soft. Then he caught hold of me. I didn't like that much, for I was very tender underneath now, and I had no skin on, and threw me into the water. It smarted like anything, but only for a moment. After that, it became perfectly delicious. As soon as I started swimming and splashing, I found that all the pain had gone from my arm. And then I saw why. I had turned into a boy again. After a bit, the lion took me out and dressed me with his paws in new clothes, the same I've got on now, as a matter of fact. It would be nice and fairly true to say that from that point forward, Eustace was a different boy. To be strictly accurate, he began to be a different boy. He had relapses. There were still many days when he could be a very tiresome boy. But most of those I shall not notice. The cure had begun. The point of raising Lazarus from the dead is not just that Lazarus raised from the dead. Jesus tells Mary and Martha, if we do this, you will see the glory of God in this miracle. If you are open to what I am doing, if you're open to a different plan than what you have for your life, you will see the glory of God in this earth that will defeat death in a different way than what you could even imagine. The only thing that works is submission to the one and only one who can conquer sin and death. Jesus says, "I am the resurrection, I am the life. Only in him can we have true life." Jesus, my prayer for us as a congregation is that we would be people who desperately cling to you. that we would battle the temptation. We would be self-reflecting in a way that we would understand what we are drawn to in our sin and in our trauma. And rather than sifting away from you and shifting our desire to what we have, our thoughts, our plans, our desires, we would fully and more obediently submit to your will and be people who are in constant relationship with you, like in John 15. God, teach us what it looks like to be people who are in relationship with you. Teach us what it looks like to be people who aren't trying to do your work of fixing ourselves, but we submit to the fact that you are the only one who can get rid of the stench of death on our spirit. Lead us this week and to be, as we prepare to celebrate the fullest resurrection, the ultimate sacrifice, and the ultimate picture of life over death, which is you rising from the dead after your death on the cross. Prepare our hearts this holy week. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Church, let's stand together and close and sing in praise of worship. All this pain, I wonder if I ever found my way. I wonder if my life could really change at all. All this earth, could all that is lost ever be found? And could a garden come up from this ground at all? You make beautiful things, you make beautiful things out of the dust. Ground.
hey, this week, church, let us not try to fix ourselves. Would you go into this week being self-reflective, having the opportunity for Holy Week? What a week for us to reflect on the work of Jesus, being the only one who resurrects death to life. Let us reflect. And there's a personal element. Jesus weeps personally. He wants us to have a personal relationship with him, but he is the only one who does the work. So this week, fight the temptation that you are doing something for yourself and realize that anything you do is a response to the one and only one who offers life. Be blessed this week. If you are new with us, we'd love to meet you right outside by the fire pit at a five-minute party, get some cookies and meet some of the pastors over there. Pastor Glenn will be over there. And then we'll also have some people up here. If you just need prayer, we'd love to pray for you. We'll have a few people up here where we would just love to meet you and pray for you as well. So be blessed, church. Have an amazing week, and we'll see you next week for Easter. Bye.